A couple of years ago, I was reading in Reader's Digest and came across a story called The Night I Met Einstein. I thought that you, as loyal 3Bs listeners, would love to hear the story. We bring it to you now, dramatized, for your listening pleasure. When I was a very young man, just beginning to make my way, I was invited to dine at the home of a distinguished New York philanthropist. After dinner, our hostess led us to an enormous drawing room. Other guests were pouring in, and my eyes beheld two unnerving sights. Servants were arranging small gilt chairs in long, neat rows, and up front, leaning against the wall, were musical instruments. Apparently, I was in for an evening of chamber music. I use the phrase in for because music meant nothing to me. I am almost completely tone deaf. Only with great effort can I carry the simplest tune, and serious music was to me no more than an arrangement of noises. So I did what I always did when trapped. I sat down, and when the music started, I fixed my face in what I hoped was an expression of intelligent appreciation, closed my ears from the inside, and submerged myself in my own completely irrelevant thoughts. After a while, becoming aware that the people around me were applauding, I concluded that it was safe to unplug my ears. At once, I heard a gentle but surprisingly penetrating voice on my right.
You are fond of Bach?
I knew as much about Bach as I know about nuclear fission, but I did know one of the most famous faces in the world, with the renowned shock of untidy white hair and the ever-present pipe between the teeth. I was sitting next to Albert Einstein. Well, I said uncomfortably and hesitated. I had been asked a casual question. All I had to do was be equally casual in my reply. But I could see from the look in my neighbor's extraordinary eyes that their owner was not merely going through the perfunctory duties of elementary politeness. Regardless of what value I placed on my part in the verbal exchange, to this man, his part in it mattered very much. Above all, I could feel that this was a man to whom you did not tell a lie, no matter how small. I don't know anything about Bach. I've never heard any of his music. A look of perplexed astonishment washed across Einstein's mobile face.
You have never heard Bach?
He made it sound as though I'd said I'd never taken a bath. It isn't that I don't want to like Bach. It's just that I'm tone deaf, or almost tone deaf, and I've never really heard anybody's music.
Please, you will come with me?
He stood up and took my arm. I stood up. As he led me across the crowded room, I kept my embarrassed glance fixed on the carpet. A rising murmur of puzzled speculation followed us out into the hall. Einstein paid no attention to it. Resolutely, he led me upstairs. He obviously knew the house well. On the floor above, he opened the door into a book-lined study, drew me in, and shut the door.
Now, you will tell me, please, how long you have felt this way about music?
All my life. I wish you would go back downstairs and listen, Dr. Einstein. The fact that I don't enjoy music doesn't matter. He shook his head and scowled, as though I had introduced an irrelevance.
Tell me, please, is there any kind of music that you do like?
Well, I like songs that have words and the kind of music where I can follow the tune. He smiled and nodded, obviously pleased.
You can give me an example, perhaps?
Well, almost anything by Bing Crosby.
Good.
He went to a corner of the room, opened a phonograph, and started pulling out records. I watched him uneasily. At last, he beamed.
Ah.
He put the record on, and in a moment the study was filled with the relaxed, lilting strains of Bing Crosby's Where the Blue of the Night Meets the Gold of the Day.
Where the blue of the night meets the gold.
Einstein beamed at me and kept time with the stem of his pipe. After three or four phrases, he stopped the music.
Now, will you tell me, please, what you have just heard?
The simplest answer seemed to be to sing the lines, and I did just that, trying desperately to stay in tune and keep my voice from cracking. When the blue of the night meets the gold of the day.
You see, you do have an ear.
The expression on Einstein's face was like the sunrise. I mumbled something about this being one of my favorite songs, something I had heard hundreds of times, so that it didn't really prove anything.
Nonsense. It proves everything. Do you remember your first arithmetic lesson in school? Suppose, at your very first contact with numbers, your teacher had ordered you to work out a problem in, say, long division of fractions. Could you have done so?
No, of course not.
Precisely. It would have been impossible, and you would have reacted in panic. You would have closed your mind to long division and fractions. As a result, because of that one small mistake by your teacher, it is possible your whole life you would be denied the beauty of long division and fractions. But on your first day, no teacher would be so foolish. He would start you with elementary things. Then, when you had acquired the skill with the simplest problems, he would lead you up to long division and to fractions. So it is with music. This simple, charming little song is like simple addition or subtraction. You have mastered it. Now, we go on to something more complicated.
He found another record and set it going. The golden voice of John McCormick singing The Trumpeter filled the room.
Trumpeter, what are you sounding now? Is it the call I'm seeking? You'll know the call that the trumpeter call when my trumpeter goes a-speaking.
So, you will sing that back to me, please?
I did, with a good deal of self-consciousness, but with, for me, a surprising degree of accuracy.
Trumpeter, what are you sounding now? Is it the call I'm seeking? You'll know the call, said the trumpeter tall, when my trumpet goes a-speaking.
Einstein stared at me with a look on his face that I had only seen once before in my life, on the face of my father, as he listened to me deliver the valedictory address at my high school graduation.
Excellent. Wonderful. Now this.
This proved to be Caruso in what was to me a completely unrecognizable fragment of Cavalleria Rusticana. Nevertheless, I managed to reproduce an approximation of the sounds the famous tenor had made. Einstein beamed with approval. Caruso was followed by at least a dozen others. I could not shake my feeling of awe over the way this great man, in whose company I had been thrown by chance, was completely preoccupied by what we were doing, as though I were his sole concern. We came at last to recordings of music without words, which I was instructed to reproduce by humming. When I reached for a high note, Einstein's mouth opened and his head went back as if to help me attain what seemed unattainable. Evidently, I came close enough, for he suddenly turned off the phonograph.
Now, young man, we are ready for Bach.
As we returned to our seats in the drawing room, the players were tuning up for a new selection. Einstein smiled and gave me a reassuring pat on the knee.
Just allow yourself to listen. That is all.
It wasn't really all, of course. Without the effort he had just poured out for a total stranger, I would never have heard, as I did that night for the first time in my life, Bach's Sheep May Safely Graze. I have heard it many times since. I don't think I shall ever tire of it, because I never listen to it alone. I'm sitting beside a small, round man with a shock of untidy white hair, a dead pipe clamped between his teeth, and eyes that contain in their extraordinary warmth all the wonder of the world. When the concert was finished, I added my genuine applause to that of the others. Suddenly, our hostess confronted us.
I'm so sorry, Dr. Einstein, that you missed so much of the performance.
Einstein and I came hastily to our feet.
I am sorry, too. My young friend here and I, however, were engaged in the greatest activity of which man is capable.
Really? And what is that?
Einstein smiled and put his arm across my shoulders, and he uttered 10 words that, at least for one person who is in his endless debt, are his epitaph.
Opening up yet another fragment of the frontier of beauty.
We heard The Night I Met Einstein by Jerome Weidman, which was originally printed in Reader's Digest in November of 1955. We air it with permission of Reader's Digest and with our great thanks. The story was dramatized for radio by yours truly and produced in the studios of Classical 90.5 WSMC by Brendan Dodd. The part of Einstein was played by Brendan Dodd. Jerome Weidman was played and sung by Robbie Rainey. Their hostess for the evening was Brittany Baldwin Parrish. Musical selections included When the Blue of the Night Meets the Gold of the Day, sung by Bing Crosby, The Trumpeter, sung by John McCormick, the first and last movements of Bach's Partita for Solo Flute, BWV Listing 1013, performed by Sir James Galway. We heard The Moldau by Bedrich Smetana, performed by the Russian National Orchestra, led by Vakhtang Jordania, and we ended with Sheep May Safely Graze, performed by the Philadelphia Orchestra. I'd like to thank Emily Kerlinski, our operations manager here at WSMC, for her supervision and oversight in this project. Her creativity has been absolutely inspiring to me.